Hi, everybody. This is AllDayLive, and we're going to cover this week in the late part of November. Of course, if you study the independent media, what is independent media? Well, according to a party named Feinstein, she says only they will choose who can be independent media. Guess what? You know, Dianne Feinstein, I think her name is. How do these people get elected? Maybe after this segment that we're going to hear from our panel, and we're going to cover some things that...
Gentlemen, we have called you together to inform you that we are going to overthrow the United States government.
You still think that jet fuel brought down the World Trade Center? Does anybody else see a problem here? If the government has nothing to hide, why are they so afraid?
But we begin tonight with a tale of two speeches, both from the same man, both from President Obama. One speech that could have been billed as a ballad to the Constitution, a proclamation of American values, a repudiation of the lawless behavior of the last presidential administration, and another speech announcing a radical new claim of presidential power that is not afforded by the Constitution and that has never been attempted in American history, even by George W. Bush and Dick Cheney. Remarkably, President Obama today made both of those speeches simultaneously. Standing inside the National Archives, in front of the actual original Constitution, President Obama delivered a blistering critique of the Bush administration, in which he called their actions and their legacy literally a mess.
Our government made a series of hasty decisions. Poorly planned, haphazard approach. Too often, we set those principles aside as luxuries that we could no longer afford. Our government made decisions based on fear rather than foresight. The decisions that were made over the last 8 years established an ad hoc legal approach for fighting terrorism that was neither effective nor sustainable.
An ad hoc legal approach for fighting terrorism that was neither effective nor sustainable. Ouch. Then, moments later, he announced his own ad hoc legal approach for fighting terrorism. President Obama today proposed something new, something called prolonged detention. Doesn't sound that bad, right? Prolonged detention. Did you ever see the movie Minority Report? It was based on a Philip K. Dick short story, came out in 2002. It starred Tom Cruise, remember? He played a police officer in something called the Department of Pre-Crime. Pre-crime is where people are arrested and incarcerated to prevent crimes that they have not yet committed.
Mr. Marks, by mandate of the District of Columbia Pre-Crime Division, I'm placing you under arrest for the future murder of Sarah Marks and Donald Dubinos. Take place today, April 22nd, at 0800 hours, 4 minutes.
No, I didn't do anything.
You didn't do anything, but you're gonna. Future murder. Creepy, right? Putting somebody in jail not for what they've done, but for what you're very sure they're going to do?
There may be a number of people who cannot be prosecuted for past crimes. In some cases, because evidence may be tainted. But who nonetheless pose a threat to the security of the United States.
We're not prosecuting them for past crimes, but we need to keep them in prison because of our expectation of their future crimes.
Al-Qaeda terrorists and their affiliates are at war with the United States, and those that we capture, like other prisoners of war, must be prevented from attacking us again.
Prevented. We will incarcerate people preventively. Preventive incarceration. Indefinite detention without trial. That's what this is. That's what President Obama proposed today, if you strip away the euphemisms. One civil liberties advocate told the New York Times today, quote, "We've known this was on the horizon for many years, but we were able to hold it off with George Bush. The idea that we might find ourselves fighting with the Obama administration over these powers is really stunning." And it is stunning, particularly to hear President Obama claim the power to keep people in prison indefinitely with no charges against them, no conviction, no sentence, just imprisonment. It's particularly stunning to hear him make that claim in the middle of a speech that was all about the rule of law.
But we must do so with an abiding confidence in the rule of law. Our government was defending positions that undermine the rule of law to ensure that they are in line with the rule of law.
How can a president speak the kind of poetry that President Obama does about the rule of law and call for the power to indefinitely, preventively imprison people because they might commit crimes in the future? How can those two things coexist in the same man, even in the same speech? Well, that brings us to the self-consciously awkward, embarrassing part of this speech today. After condemning the Bush administration for what he called their ad hoc legal strategy, for trying to make things seem legal that patently weren't, this is what President Obama proposed.
My administration has begun to reshape the standards that apply to ensure that they are in line with the rule of law. We must have clear, defensible, and lawful standards for those who fall into this category. We must have a thorough process of periodic review so that any prolonged detention is carefully evaluated and justified. Our goal is to construct a legitimate legal framework for the remaining Guantanamo detainees that cannot be transferred. Our goal is not to avoid a legitimate legal framework. In our constitutional system, prolonged detention should not be the decision of any one man. If and when we determine that the United States must hold individuals to keep them from carrying out an act of war, we will do so within a system that involves judicial and congressional oversight. And so going forward, my administration will work with Congress to develop an appropriate legal regime so that our efforts are consistent with our values and our Constitution.
You'll construct a legal regime to make indefinite detention legal. You will, what does he say? Develop an appropriate legal regime. So you can construct a whole new system outside the courts, even outside the military commissions, so that you can indefinitely imprison people without charges. And you'll build that system from scratch. What's that somebody said about ad hoc legal strategies? Just for context here, in the United Kingdom, where there isn't even a Bill of Rights, there's been a major debate about whether people can be held in preventive detention. Former British Prime Minister Tony Blair wanted 3 months to be the outer limit for how long anyone could be held. There was a big political fight about it. Parliament ended up limiting that power to 28 days. 28 days is still the longest period of preventive detention that's allowed under law in any comparable democracy anywhere in the world. How long would President Obama's proposed preventive indefinite detention last? Well, he's not saying yet, but here's how he defines the threat that he says makes indefinite detention necessary.
Right now, in distant training camps and in crowded cities, there are people plotting to take American lives. That will be the case a year from now, 5 years from now, and in all probability, 10 years from now.
10 years from now. So you could get arrested today and locked up without a trial, without being convicted, without being sentenced for, say, 10 years until the threat of your future criminal behavior passes. Prolonged detention, he's calling it. This was a beautiful speech from President Obama today with patriotic, moving, even poetic language about the rule of law and the Constitution, and one of the most radical proposals for defying the Constitution that we have ever heard made to the American people.
Hi, everybody. This is All Day Live, and we are going to cover in late November here a circumstance of hearing from us, at least those of us who are going to be making some statements. And we've got Professor-Gizmo, and we have other parties here as well. We have a cannabis advocate right there in the middle, Mr. B. And I think I can also figure out the party on the right, your right, my left, your right, whatever. And you're Kalusha?
I'm Adriana.
Adriana, we're greatly honored to have you guys here today. And we're going to cover some things about talking about what's happening in the world, such as like cities on Mars, stuff like that, which is in the background. I guess it would be something interesting to bring up, because we're cities here on Earth, but we're not on Mars. Professor, you covered some things that we were going to show here. We already showed one. And that is the hearing about 502. Yeah, it's monopolism versus medical cannabisism. Right. So we're looking at the form of the beginning of a monopoly, right?
That and the whole
You're not speaking into the microphone.
Yeah, well, hopefully it'll be
no, you need the standalone. There you go.
Yeah, it's coming down to it, you know, the medical versus I-502. You know, as I told everybody a long time ago, no on I-502, it's a trick. But, yeah, there's a rally protest coming up tomorrow and the next day. Might be too late for people to hear about it, but you can always write your congressman or your legislature in the Olympia and sway them, hopefully, to keep medical the way it is, the way we voted it in, the people of Washington, and keep it separate from the monopoly of recreational I-502 marijuana. And
So this is this week, which once they see this, it will be after that, right?
Yeah, but you can still write into to Olympia, to your legislatures, and to the governor to, you know, protect medical rights and leave them the way they are.
Right. And you're going to be there, so we'll get a
report. Oh, yeah, I'm leaving tomorrow and going to be down there Thursday and Friday.
Yeah. Okay, Adriana, we've showed a segment, we're going to show a segment of Obama on the FEMA camps. You had a statement you wanted to make about that, and I'm looking forward to hearing that. Could you get us up to speed on that?
Yeah, basically, I didn't think he needed to be impeached. Like, I really didn't care who was president because, like, we had this constitution that guaranteed us basic human rights, and I really didn't care what happened as long as the president didn't violate those. So then I found out that Obama is like building like hundreds of FEMA camps and he's going to send innocent people there, like who haven't yet committed crimes, but he suspects they might commit crimes in the future and he's gonna hold them indefinitely. There's room for 200 million people in all these camps. And basically the people who are going to be sent there are people who are considered a threat to the security of the nation. And that's the exact same reason that Hitler gave when he established concentration camps. Nobody at that point questioned Hitler. Everyone thought it was for like the greater good, and they all called him the German word for father of the nation. And that's pretty much the same attitude people have about Obama in America. And yeah, it's just like they all idolize him like everyone idolized Hitler, and Hitler was like gonna save the economy because of the communists and stuff, so everyone was like all prepared to accept him as a leader, and then everyone in the US was prepared to accept Obama as a leader too. And I mean, it was pretty hard to like fix everything because there's so many things that are going wrong with the US. So I was like, yeah, it's okay if Obama's not perfect. But I mean, there's really no excuse for throwing innocent people into jail, basically. So basically in Germany, everyone had biased views of Hitler. They all imagined that he was like their savior. And that allowed him to establish concentration camps, which led to the Holocaust. So, like, we basically need to learn from the past and not allow that to happen again. So I think we need to impeach Obama because he already admitted that he was going to violate the Constitution, which is the only thing that guarantees our human rights. Like, basically, nobody is safe from FEMA camps. He could do it to anybody. There's no way to tell if anybody's going to commit a crime in the future. Like, absolutely no way. And if he puts everyone who disagrees with him into FEMA camps, then, like, he can just get elected again and again, and there will be no end to people's sentences in the FEMA camps. And they're not even guilty. They haven't even committed crimes yet. So, like a famous English judge, William Blackcomb, said, it was better that 10 guilty men walk free than one innocent man suffer. And yeah, that's why Obama should be impeached, because he's basically just throwing innocent people into prisons, and it's really screwed up. So imagine if Hitler's concentration camps were abolished before they even started. Millions of innocent, like, Jews and people wouldn't have suffered like they did. And like the Nazis told everyone that concentration camps were safe places for Jews to go, where that it was, they basically advertised them as spas. So that's kind of, you could compare that to the sugar-coated explanation that a lot of people have heard, that FEMA camps are safe places to go in case of an emergency. There's enough room in FEMA camps so far to hold 200 million people, and there's still more being built. So yeah, it's pretty much an abomination. You could change that to an O and say O-bomination. Albert Einstein said, the world will not be destroyed by those who do evil, but by those who see evil and do nothing about it. So you guys should just take a stand for your rights and abolish FEMA camps before it gets out of hand. That's all I have to say right now.
Thank you a lot. We really appreciate that. And that's the what you're kind of talking about in the background here.
My name's Brian, or B here. Sorry, it doesn't matter. I don't care. I was gonna remind people that we did have our own concentration camps here. And if you remember in 1940s and that, they interned the Japanese all across the country and locked them all up, confiscated their property, took away their rights. And so it's nothing new to this country. It's happened before, and it can happen to any of us, just no matter what color, what race, or religion. I don't know any guidelines on FEMA for being innocent or guilty, but if they're making the camps, they're probably going to want to use them.
Well, and if you don't think Obama wants to use them, you know, one of his first promises when he first became president, he claimed he was going to shut down Guantanamo Bay, and he still hasn't done that to this day, and doesn't propose to. So he's willing to use these camps and use them illegally.
Yeah.
Unconstitutionally.
And one thing that we are a people, you guys are stepping forward, very few people do, you know. So it takes a little bit of that. I don't think we have anything to be fear of. Imagine if
Obama's a terrorist, you know. We gave you the 1-800 number to turn in terrorist, and if you feel that way, yeah, you should maybe report him as one.
Right.
People think that prisoners have rights in this country, but they really don't. People say that there's no cruel and unusual punishment, but really the guards in some jails in the U.S., like, they probably don't even know what the Constitution is because of the way that they treat the inmates there. It's really horrible.
Thank you. Any last statement, Brian?
I agree.
Yeah, and so, you know, give us liberty and give us freedom. And also, there's a big thing coming up, you know, with, this medical marijuana. They're taking it's like a medical genocide, you know, because there's patients that won't be able to get their medicine that normally could grow their own or have their own medicine that's, detailed to their specific problem. And they want to make it all a Monsanto's type generic recreational marijuana, which I'm against. And down with the FEMA camps and down with I-502.
Awesome. And then, Gizmo, we're going to show some clips that you did at Westlake Center, the Occupy Homeless Awareness, right? That was
the
19th of November down at Westlake Center in Seattle.
Yeah, there was a music and food for the homeless and unfortunate, and there was some speakers there talking about the positive things going on with Occupy or what's left of the Occupy movement, and our new city council socialist proposing a $15 an hour minimum wage, and it was a very good event. They're handing out bedding to the homeless after they fed them, so it was a very good event, well put together.
Adriana, you want to do some more reports sometime in the future? Get kind of familiar how to do that and get your voice out there? At least somebody will. I think it's important that somebody does. Right? Is that a good deal?
Sounds good.
And keep us up to speed on this. You're kind of getting us fired, fire under
All right.
We can't fire the
character. Yeah, I'm not really sure. I can try to find more stuff. I'm not really sure how much I can find, but.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, there's an Impeach Obama page on Facebook. There's, if you want, like, if you want to learn more about it, that's probably a good place to go.
The problem is that he may destroy planet Earth before we can impeach. That's the problem. Seems like he's done a great job. I did hear
a rumor that somebody dumped a bunch of, like, radioactive waste into the ocean and starfish started melting.
Well, no. The Fukushima is an extinction event that's bigger than anybody could comprehend, and we're in the middle of it, and no one's doing anything about it. I mentioned at the University of Washington, 19th of November last night, on the Hanford contamination, and I brought up in front of the panel, there's quite a few, about 300-400 people there at the Student Union Hall, the Husky Hub, and I had to bring this up because no one's aware of radionics or radiesthesia. These are answers to this, and also Brown's gas, hydroxy water, plasma will actually neutralize nuclear. Of course, you're not supposed to know about transmutation in physics. We're not supposed to know that. There's a whole lot of things they've kept us from knowing anything of, including the lies coming from the fact that Fukushima has now contaminated the entire northern hemisphere and will wipe out all human life in 400 years. Of course, we're not supposed to know that either. And they're trying to cover up. I showed the thing from Rents.com of what they're doing to people speaking out on them. Anyway, everybody, we're going to have to start getting more up to speed up to more and things like that. One last statement, Professor?
Yeah, get out there and, join any good protests that you want. Call your legislatures in Olympia and voice your opinion and get active and be prepared. You never know. We got this comet Ison coming towards us. Everybody be prepared.
Eye on top of the pyramid.
This is a new event we've never witnessed before.
Okay, we're going to have to get on to the next segments we're going to show here, so everybody hang in there. Thank you, everyone, for coming in. Thank you for being here.
Thank you, Will. We appreciate it.
Thank you. And thank you, Adriana. And Mr. B, thank you. Okay, we'll see you guys on the next show.
All right, Adriana,
we'll get another report. Sound good?
Thank you.
Yeah, sounds good.
Thank you, everybody. We'll see you next week.
Yay.
Enjoy the clips coming up. All right.
I know not what costs others, but as for me,
give me liberty or give me death.
Truth Stream Media with Aaron Dykes and Melissa Melton on Unbound Radio.
Well, we actually have a list of stuff here that we wanted to kind of bring up having to do with things that DARPA has come out with, because I think all the time in the news we're seeing people talk.
We're thinking of a whole variety of options for how you could do better at authentication. So you can start with nearer-term things like tokens or fobs that might have NFC or Bluetooth embedded in them, but you can also think about a means of authentication that you could simply wear on your skin every day for a week at a time, say an electronic tattoo. Now, we're talking about wearables. Everybody's interested in wearables. I'm profoundly interested in wearables. And what I will tell you is that we've made a lot of advances in wearables, but there's still some fundamental problems that we haven't solved. Like, one of them is the mechanical mismatch between humans and electronics, right? So electronics are boxy and rigid, humans are curvy.
One really good spouse is going to be married to this really horrific, sick person. Mm-hmm. So she's got to have a few trouble spots herself.
Okay, this is all really remarkable. You said somebody cut a deal for him somewhere along the line. Where do you think it might have happened? Now, his mother was there, and I think you saw her maybe one time, just very briefly. You never engaged her.
He didn't have any supervision. Neither did any of us, really. So to be fair, I didn't really see parents of most everybody.
Any of your friends to speak of?
Yeah, because in the
I finally realize why the world is flat. When the sun sets on the stationary globe, the sun is beneath it, and darkness covers the face of the world. World War II gave us the Holocaust, and the Jews keep giving it back. Ben Stein of CBS says a second Holocaust will come if America makes peace with Iran. Iran is so big, and Israel is so small. A nuclear bomb flying all the way from Iran will wipe us out, says Stein. Alan Dershowitz calls it a Chamberlain moment. He was weak, but Churchill was strong, he says, and scorned the appeasement as defeat without war. War with defeat is better, just ask Churchill. And to the survivors go the spoils. It's all so simple when reaping the past through Jewish eyes. History is flat and ripe for harvest. The Holocaust won the war and is now on tour in Iran. Just as Chamberlain gave Hitler the Reich and time to build the camps, Kerry gives Rouhani time to build a bomb when no one's looking and drop it on 6 million. The Holocaust gets a rerun. Increase the sanctions, demands Dershowitz, and keep the military option on the table. In legalese, those are fighting words and herald a hate crime. But Dershowitz is a good Jewish lawyer and kept a running black out of jail. Abe Foxman wants more. He wants crippling sanctions against Iran. In foreign affairs, a specialty among Jews, that's called bringing your enemy to his knees and clubbing him on his head. I know there's a lot of people in Iran, at least 6 million. That's a lot of heads for Foxman to club. He'll make cripples out of them all. After telling Congress that it's in the Iranian people's DNA to deceive, State Department negotiator Wendy Sherman rushed to Israel presenting the evidence. She brought the blood and it can't be denied. We're told the Holocaust happened too. Only Jews survived and you can't deny it. If you do and live in Germany, they'll put you in jail. If you live in America, you can be a Holocaust denier too. All you have to do is want peace between America and Iran. But when senators say sanctions are good and diplomacy is bad, then a Holocaust museum with a Jewish flag casts a long shadow, and darkness covers the face of deep reason. Wendy's got the DNA and Wolfowitz the WMD. That's all the reason you need. Just ask the people of Iraq. Perhaps it's better to deny yourself than to offend the Jews. Chuck Hagel did, and look where it got him. He denied every word and got a good job. Life is short. The earth is flat. And when Jews make cowards out of soldiers, then you know the Holocaust is on tour again.
To get the signatures we need to put an initiative on the ballot for the people of Seattle to vote for a $50 an hour minimum wage in November 2014.
All right!
Yeah. We deserve a $15 an hour minimum wage, and this will be a massive step forward for addressing the homelessness crisis. But it won't be easy. We know through history that elected officials are limited in what they can do to fight for real change. And that social movements are historically what makes real change for working people. It will be our communities coming together that will make this difference. In early 2014, we want to have a rally of 10,000 people in Seattle to demand a $15 an hour minimum wage. We can do these things, and we can get a $15 an hour minimum wage if we fight for it and if we continue building coalitions to stand up for our communities and the needs of ordinary people above the desires of big business. So I'm here working on the Shama Sawant campaign, but I live in Minneapolis, where I'm a member of Occupy Homes Minnesota, where building coalitions and community power has been crucial for us getting a dozen victories against the big banks and successfully keeping families in their homes. I also want to bring a message of solidarity from Occupy Homes Minnesota and thank you all for your amazing work. Our most recent victory was just last week. And yesterday, community members occupied the sheriff's office in Minnesota, in Hennepin County, demanding justice for a retired, lifelong resident of my neighborhood named Jamie Kelly. The first time the sheriffs came to evict Jamie, they were met by 150 neighbors protecting her home. And so they drove by. But the banks didn't like that. So the second time they evicted her, they came in the middle of the night and tore her and her daughter out of their home and took their cell phones away so they couldn't call us for help. But we moved her back in that same day. And that was 2 weeks ago, and Jamie is still in her home. Yet despite paying for the value of her home more than five times over, Jamie could be evicted by the police any day. And we think it's outrageous that police resources are used to tear families out of their homes. But it doesn't have to be like this. It's true both in Minneapolis and in Seattle, there are more empty homes than there are homeless people. Yeah. And this is not a resource crisis. It's not a scarcity crisis. It's a priority crisis. Right. The banks are making record profits off the destruction of our communities. And we can fight back if we join together. So from everybody in the Shama Sawant campaign, I want to thank you all for putting this together. Thank you.
Thank you. Occupy everywhere. So, tell me, my friend, you remember me from Occupy, don't you?
Oh, my God, yeah. How you doing?
Good, good see to see you. Yeah.
All right.
Is Occupy starting back up again,
Thank
or what?
Thank you very much, Kelly. And now, if everybody could join us over here by our dinner tent, we have a community meal brought to us by Operation Sack Lunch. And
hot meal.
Hot meal. Free food. Thank you, everyone.
Food, not bombs.
Fed by the homeless.
Yeah.
And your dinner music for tonight will be provided by Gary Cantor and John Sparrow.
Nice.
Enjoy.
Thank you.
I don't have enough channels. I could give you two homeless. No, I can't.
Okay, I don't think John's here.
Okay, maybe he took off. Yeah, maybe you got it.
Hi.
What's your name?
I'm Gizmo.
Gizmo, Gary.
Yeah.
I think we've met before.
Yeah, I was Occupy, stronghold in Occupy.
Yep.
Long-time resident.
Okay.
So is Occupy starting back up again, or what's going on, man? So is Occupy starting back up again, or what?
Occupy has metastasized, I think, in a good way.
Metastasized, yeah.
I mean, there's like Occupy Check. It's
got a long drive back to Pierce County.
People from Occupy working in the transit riders.
They'll have to get there by dawn.
Okay.
Safe, the folks that are doing the foreclosure stuff or Occupy folks. So I don't know that Occupy as it existed.
Right.
Well.
Unfortunately, yeah. So Occupy is still kind of dead, but this is a...
I wouldn't say dead.
Okay.
It's transformed.
Yeah, transformed.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's how I view it.
Okay.
And the spirit of Occupy will live as long as we keep it in our hearts.
Oh, yeah. You know me?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I talked to one of the bicycle cops. He said he still had a picture of my box shelter in front of Hallmark on his desk. Yeah. Well, I got to go up to the U District. They're having a protest meeting on Hanford and radiation.
Well, good to see you.
All that, yeah. Good to see you.
Hang in there.
Yeah, yeah. I'm still doing public access TV, so we'll put some of this on public access, you know.
Cool.
Glad you guys are down here doing this.
Yeah.
I was hoping it was like a bunch of tents starting to set up, but.
Wasn't much to look at, but then neither am I. I went to sleep for dinner and my standing bar was mine.
Scott.
She said, oh yes, she said that she could cry. Looking back, he said, all this to the boys that was down there.
Okay.
Stared at her.
A lot of people are being like that.
She said, this boy has just definitely...
How are you guys doing?
Good.
All right.
We're born.
Save our buses. Yeah. Hell yeah. Yeah.
I'm going to sign our petition.
I think I already have.
Yeah, it is. It's pretty crowded and pretty crowded.
And if you got one of these, you can
people are friendly. Not yet.
These are newsletters.
Yeah, I'm going down to Olympia Thursday and Friday to try to save medical marijuana rights. Big protest going on down there.
We're here now.
Yeah. All right. Yeah, I'm off to a protest meeting up in the U District on radiation in Hanford.
Oh, yeah, you have like a flyer or anything for it?
No, I'm just heading up there. Check it out.
All right, so what's going on right now?
Yeah.
I heard you say it. Come on. Never marry anyone you just met in a bar. Keep your eyes wide open and don't let it get that far. I'm speaking from experience.
So you heard about that protest in Olympia Thursday and Friday to try to save medical marijuana?
Yes, I did.
Yeah, tried to let everybody know. Use all the people we can down there. Screaming out in the crowd here. Anybody that cares about medical marijuana Thursday and Friday in Olympia, there's a protest. Protest in Olympia Thursday and Friday to save medical marijuana rights. There's a protest Thursday and Friday in Olympia to save medical marijuana rights. Thursday and Friday in Olympia, there's a protest to save medical marijuana rights. Thursday and Friday in Olympia, there's a protest to save medical marijuana rights.
Where and where?
At the Capitol building, Thursday and Friday.
Down in Olympia.
In Olympia, yeah.
Anytime, just be there.
Just be there, yeah.
The last meeting they had without, what was it, Lacey or
no,
something?
Yeah, no, that was I-502 meeting. This is a protest.
I've already been saying my shit to them right on the internet, man. I've been sending them emails.
Okay. Do that. But anyways,
done with that,
man. Let everybody know, man. Olympia, Thursday and Friday. The weather's supposed to be good, too. Protest Thursday and Friday in Olympia to save medical marijuana rights. Protest Thursday and Friday in Olympia to save medical marijuana rights. Protest Thursday and Friday at Olympia to save medical marijuana rights.
We're gathered here, we're as mad as can be. Trying to save our democracy by taking it back from the majority. We are the Tea Party.
Have a condition and you may benefit from marijuana. It does not limit amounts. It doesn't say you should try this strain or this strain. So it's not. It's just saying that instead of having 24 ounces at any given time in your possession, you can have three. So that's the simple division of 3 ounces would be to 1 week what 24 ounces was to 60 days. We're not saying that that should last 7 days, and it was probably an inartful way of showing our math. But the fact of the matter is, you can have 3 ounces today, you can have 3 ounces tomorrow, you can have 3 ounces every day of the week. It doesn't mean you only get 3 ounces to last an entire week.
It's $1,000.
What about extracts that patients need for cancer?
Or however many times they need to maintain their 3 ounces. Some people it will last them a long time, sometimes it won't last. It's an exact.
How about people who can't smoke?
Number seven is collective gardens. They are currently allowed under the law. They were intended to allow patients to work cooperatively to grow marijuana for personal medical use if they're too ill to grow for themselves or don't have the space or equipment. The original idea of the collective garden was the neighborhood garden. That people working together to grow their product. It has evolved into a for-profit retail business model known as a dispensary. That was not intended.
Just separate it, keep it the same.
10 patients at a single time and can have no more than 45 plants and 72 ounces of usable marijuana.
Already not enough.
In reality, it's
medical is not
recreational. Not work that way. Allowing these to continue would likely undermine any viable regulatory scheme and encourage illicit behavior.
No way.
Collectives are not needed anymore.
Bullshit. Bullshit.
Your scheme?
You're probably not.
Thank you, Christy.
You should think about what you're saying.
Can you guys quiet down? Show some maturity. Recreational patients don't exist, by the way.
Thank you. I'd be delighted. This is Kathy Ryan with the Department of Revenue.
Why are you involved?
Yeah, are you with the feds?
Under Initiative 502, producers, processors, and retailers are all required to pay a 25% excise tax on their sales.
On I-502?
These taxes are in addition to the state's general business and occupation.
Oh, you just want money, huh?
That most persons engaging in business activities in this state pay.
No taxation
under
without
representation. Under Initiative 502, retail buyers of recreational marijuana will also be paying state and local retail sales tax
to
retailers when they buy marijuana. Our proposed recommendation is that medical marijuana be brought under the same tax structure that Initiative 502 envisioned, with one exception. We are recommending to the board that medical marijuana patients registered with the Department of Health receive a sales tax exemption similar to current sales tax exemptions provided under state law for consumers of prescription drugs.
Thank you.
That's after a 50% excise tax has already been applied.
Thank you.
Would both be manufactured here
and the retail tier, would those be subject to B&O taxation or the excise tax? Would those be, would your interpretation be that those would apply to those?
I would like to see the exact answers, and I don't have it in minutes. But I would say, generally speaking, that everybody who does business, generally speaking, everybody who does caregivers to grow medical marijuana. Item received 362 comments. The second highest comment received was medical marijuana law and statute should remain unchanged. That received. Yeah. That issue received 237 comments. The third highest was to continue to allow for guarding and access points in medical dispensaries. That received 226 comments. Fourth highest was the draft medical marijuana recommendation for possession amounts were too small. That received 126 comments. And the fifth highest comment was that there not be single integrated system for medical and recreational marijuana.
All of those comments.
And that received 96.
Make it so.
Thank you very much to all three of you and for the work that the staff has done. Appreciate it very much.
Questions regarding the different points. Regarding point number two, authorizing requirements for medical.
See exactly what we've been getting for the last 35 years, which is $40 billion wasted, very little cleanup to show for it, not one drop of high-level waste taken care of, and a lot of doubt about what is happening out there. So I think that we need to make that change.
Thanks a lot, you guys.
My question is about Bechtel and the contractors, and I'm really hoping that the people who are in charge of Bechtel stop hiding behind the business. I think it's time to have the people, in actual people, who are benefiting economically and with whatever power they think they have. We need pictures of them, we need their names, we need their families, and let's stop protecting these people. I believe that what's going on is genocide and is very criminal, and I think we need to know who is benefiting directly and to stop protecting them. People by just saying the names of their businesses.
One of the problems with addressing Bechtel or challenging Bechtel is Bechtel is a private company. Riley Bechtel is the chairman. you were to write somebody, you could go on the internet, you can pull his picture up, you can write him. The significance, though, of being a private company is they do not have to put the rest of it into stockholders. They do not have to adhere to the Sarbanes-Oxley law. They are can operate in the dark because they're a private company. Now, the revenue is $33 billion a year. $33 billion. The company I work for, URS, is $11 billion. So think of that. I work for a big company, and Bechtel's three times bigger, and they're private. Everything goes up to Riley Bechtel. They don't have to answer to anybody. They put their money in lobbyists to control the environment around them. And they have no, there's like even no laws. I don't want to say no laws, but they do not have to adhere to all laws that a public company has to adhere to.
So my question, I can project. You guys, it's a two-part question. So you spoke of several cases of worker abuses and cover-ups. Can you give us an estimate of how common these cases might be? And secondly, and I mean discrimination, health issues, safety issues. And secondly, if there are third-party safety managers who are independent of corporate interest and don't have that conflict of interest, how common is it that they don't have a manager that's overseeing them? That way they do have the freedom to speak what's happening on the job.
So how common and like the oversight?
Yes.
Hi, I'm WillPWilson. I produce the All Day Live show on public access TV locally here. And several things that I don't know if you're aware of. About Brown's gas, hydroxy gas, Dr. Neil Brown, the discovery of nuclear chemistry, Michael Wells, Manville, myself, WillPWilson, nuclear chemistry, the discovery of the destruction of the nuclear proton. You can go online and look it up. Also, Brown's gas, hydroxy gas, not only superhydrated water will help remove it faster out of our human bodies, including organic medical cannabis. There's many things involved, and also the science of radionics and radiesthesia. I think it's time that we wake up to other things, and maybe they paid a lot of money to keep us from knowing it, but now it's maybe time for us to know this. Radiesthesia, radionics, the use of Brown's gas, hydroxy gas, superhydrated water, and organic medical cannabis. Serious things to think about and start learning and start applying this other knowledge. Thank you very much. You can watch All Day Live weekly and archive at clcommunitymedia.com. Thank you.
Yay.
So I guess I'll just project. Recently, Bill Gates has endorsed Terra Power. Have you heard about that at all?
About what power?
So recently, Bill Gates has endorsed Terra Power, which is kind of just utilizing the nuclear waste that our country has to power, to just create power by burning uranium-235, I believe, which is the leftover nuclear waste. And so I'm just wondering if there's potential for Hanford, if that technology could ever reach Hanford.
And Washington State, but information was released, and in Yakima, Benton, and Franklin counties, a high level of anencephalic pregnancy defects occurred. And this wasn't a small amount. The usual amount is between 1 and 2 per 1,000 births. And in these three counties, it was up to 8 in per 1,000 births. And so this
the Yakima Nation truly believes that a lot of the problems we have is related to the release. Now you've got the downwinder factor, assuming that wind always blows up. But if you look at the weather patterns, that is now very poignant on TV today.
And very reliable
chance.
I've used one of these for many years. So what were the two companies again? That one was that?
One was Safecast.com.
Safecast.com.
And the other is MedCom.
MedCom.
And I believe Safecast and MedCom are working together.
Okay. Like, that's to get Geiger counters.
Okay. Yeah.
Sometimes are you donate them or discount them?
I was going to mention that I tried to get it out there. It's not known, but we had found, I headed up a team of scientists in 1993, Mike Wells Mandeville, Frank Stanzi, Gary Hawkins, and myself, WillPWilson. We filed a U.S. patent because we found that you can neutralize the nuclear proton instantly using hydroxy gas in a plasma state. And that was
I don't understand what you just said.
I know you don't. You wouldn't. And if you can email me or I can email you, I can send you the information on that.
Okay.
And the science of radionics, radiesthesia, are you familiar with that?
Radiesthesia. Oh, radiesthesia.
No. Radionics. Dr. Galen Hieronymus, Dr. Sarah Hieronymus, all those people. Can I send information for you to get up to speed on that?
Yeah.
And would you be interested in doing some future TV shows?
Maybe, sure. Why not?
And like, for example,
this is very critical,
plus the blowing off of depleted uranium munitions from Yakima firing range, all that.
Yeah.
This is serious stuff.
It sure is.
And it's like a...
We're fouling our nest, man.
Yeah.
And not only for ourselves, but for many future generations.
Yeah.
We're just starting to feel the effects, you know. I mean, I remember hearing years ago about, you know, the Navy dumped 50-gallon metal drums of nuclear waste. It was good for 50 years.
200,000 metal drums, including Russia's done the same.
All right. Yeah. They're starting to open up now, too, probably, you know.
Great conference. We really appreciate it.
Good.
I'm Will, by the way.
Michael.
Nice to meet you.
Yeah, you got to talk right into it like that. Okay, you guys share that.
Okay, go ahead. I'm meow, meow, meow.
Okay, I'm on.
Meow,
meow, meow,
meow. Hello? I don't really hear anything.
Come on, come sit down. Get mic'd up.